Welcome back to Go Fund This. Hey, I absolutely love that our show is making a difference. I've had a number of people email to let me know they back the projects that we've discussed here, and I've seen some people sharing these projects on their own social media that I know are listeners. I congratulate you on being active participants in making dreams come true. It feels great, right? Getting the word out about a project is a big challenge. I always feel like I have to be an expert marketer, an expert in social media, or an expert in public relations just to get a little attention. And now, there's so much noise to cut through, it's incredibly tough to even get your message to your friends and followers. Aside from being a podcaster and owning a media company, I have an MBA in marketing, which I got because I wanted to be better at marketing my projects. On this podcast, I not only want to raise awareness of incredible projects, but I want to try to help others succeed. Each show, before the interview portion, I plan to give a tip that will hopefully help someone figure out a crucial step or get off on the right foot with their crowdfunding efforts. Just like many of you, I'm always searching for new ideas and ways to improve. So if you have a tip and you want me to share it, reach out on either our Facebook group or send me an email at southgatemediagroup@gmail.com. Okay, today's tip. Don't cut off a potential audience because you don't like a platform. You need to get your message out to as many as possible, right? You can't do that if the audience isn't there to hear you. Can you imagine making a TV commercial, putting in all that time writing, hiring actors, renting equipment to make it look amazing, and then only showing it on the TVs in your home? It's kind of like that if you only promote your project to your followers on Facebook and ignore every other platform. I've had so many people tell me that they won't promote on Twitter because they don't like it personally, or they don't even have an account. I've seen friends with amazing Patreon pages only promote them on their personal Instagram accounts and to the same 95 people again and again. This is a big mistake. We have free access to a number of different social media platforms and the ability to promote on them for free, and many of us only use a fraction of this potential. Keep in mind, there are people out there that use only one platform, and that's all. If you don't go to them, they won't even know your project exists. Let's say you have an Indiegogo up right now. Ask yourself where and how often you're telling people. Not only do people have platform preferences, they need to encounter a message an average of 8 times before even noticing it, let alone take action, like clicking on it to check out your project. Make it easy on them. Make sure you post to Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter at least once a day during the course of your crowdfunding event. This is not overkill. You're not going to tick anybody off. Change the message up and people won't get bored by it. Action always beats inaction. Update. The Cryptic Closet 2 Kickstarter ended and crushed it. This project was backed to almost $8,000, meaning they not only hit their goal, but unlocked all their killer stretch goals that I had discussed with Ben Miller when he was on the show. Way to go, guys. That's awesome. It definitely helps when I know you supported because of hearing this show. So please drop me a message and let me know. Or better yet, when you share that you contributed, use the hashtag GoFundThisPodcast, all one word, on social media. This will let the creators know that their interview helped their cause and help me know that we're having an impact. Okay, let's get into this episode. So today I have game designer Colin Kyle with me, and we're discussing his newest Kickstarter for the role-playing game Axon Punk Expanded. Here's the story from his Kickstarter. Hip-hop-infused cyberpunk role-playing, bigger and better than ever. The net grows. Megacities claw their way further into the sky. Megacorps sink their hooks deeper into humanity's psyche. The only thing left to do is call up the crew, crank up the beats, and get to business. Axon Punk Overdrive is back for all you I's and AI's out there, bigger and better than ever. We're going full color, adding more art, new layout, new missions, new enemies, and expanded gear, chems, vehicles, and power suits. It's a hip-hop-infused cyberpunk of our dreams, fully realized. No limits, no apologies. I'll have links to Colin's social media and the Kickstarter in the show notes, so please check it out and support this project whatever ways you can. All right, let's talk Axon Punk. Here's Colin. Colin, welcome to the show. I am super excited to have you today. This project is really, really cool. Do you want to tell us about, why don't we start by, tell people about you a little bit before we jump right into the project. Who are you, Colin?
Absolutely. Nice to meet everyone. I am Colin. I'm a Hyde Park resident in Chicago. I have a background in science, and so I actually went to UChicago, got a PhD in ecology and evolution a few years ago, but now I have been spending my time for the past few years in game design and focusing on tabletop role-playing games, and I started a company with my brother, and it's called Wrong Brothers Gaming, and so we made our first game a few years ago. We'll talk a little bit more about that later, but I love creativity. I met Rob through some local theater contacts, and so I like local theater. I love how it blends in with tabletop role-playing games. And so, yeah, I love orchids. I like gardening and things like that, and playing a lot of role-playing games.
Apparently. I'm just reading your bio. I saw all that in there. I'm like, oh, he really is committed to these things. That's awesome. Yeah. You and I are very similar with all the varied interests and definitely coming back to like gaming and having fun with stuff like this. So you got into gaming. You have this project. It's called Axon Punk. Now, this is a sequel that you're kickstarting?
So this is a expansion. Excellent question, right? Because we kickstarted the first version of the game in 2017, after about a year or so of playtesting, and it was great. It was kind of a rushed project. It was our first game. We didn't know a ton of what we were doing, and we've been working on other games in the past few years. We've really improved. My layout has improved astronomically. The readability has really been revolutionary in my layout design. And my brother has been working on the art. I do the writing and layout. He does the art and graphics and video and things like that. And so we have just really stepped up our game so much that we wanted to go back to the original one and really just basically just redo it. but all the core of the game is all the same. And we are just adding more art. We're adding extra features and bonus content. And we are, the first version was very focused on black and white, and this time we're making everything full color, which we're really excited about that, and we're going print on demand as opposed to doing it through a publisher. And so that enables us to just basically be as creative and as open-minded and as wild as we want to with this project, and we're super excited about that. So that's kind of, it's not a new edition, it's not a sequel, it's really more of like the expanded version. We still have, we remastered the original version, so you can get that too as part of our Kickstarter, but this is kind of the big, bold Axon Punk of our dreams. No Holds Barred is kind of our feeling about it.
Yeah, yeah. Now you said you're doing print on demand. Who are you doing that through?
Through a Drive-Through RPG.
Love Drive-Thru RPG. Yeah. They actually are an affiliate sponsor of a number of our different shows here our network. We have a lot of tabletop and actual play shows on our network, and we have quite a relationship with them. They're fantastic. So,
right, and getting better all the time. So,
yeah, yeah. You know. And actually, on Alley Chats, another show that I do, one of our publishers that we interviewed, Rich Perez from Tango, they were giving away – during the COVID crisis, giving away their entire library through Drive-Thru's comics thing. So they've expanded into comics and books, and it's just a fantastic site. So I'll definitely put links to your stuff at Drive-Thru in there. I can see it right now. I see you have a PDF bundle there, and you also can order the book or the paper goods, I should say. That's really, really great. The graphics are fantastic. Your brother has done a great job. On your Kickstarter page, I see you've got a test image, or is that kind of where you're going with it? Because I think it's a great cover.
Thank you. Thank you. Yeah, that's our like concept art version of the cover. It's not done yet, But that is a work in progress. You know, we've had some good feedback about it, but I love it. I love the bold colors. I love the woman in front is actually a good friend of ours who has contributed to the project. That's part of the one of the things that I really care about Axon Punk, and one of the things that we wanted right off the bat is that this game is about people. And so we really wanted to have our players be able to see themselves in the game as much as possible. And so that's why we wanted to use as many photographs of real people as possible. And one of the ways that we did that was by linking up with this fantastic group of Chicago-based group called the Sugar Gamers. And the woman in the front, her name is Keisha Howard, and she is the founder and fearless leader of the Sugar Gamers, and is brilliant, but also kills it at cosplay. And so their organization was one of the ones that really helped us finish the original Axon Punk, helped us make us feel comfortable with some of the kind of edgier and more experimental things that we were doing. We can get into that a little bit more, but yeah, that's why we a lot of the people, specifically the women and women of color in Axon Punk's art, are Chicagoans that we know, hang out with, and having that connection makes the game just so much more I don't know, accessible, more has a cool edge of realism, and it's something that I had kind of dreamed of, like early starting this project. I was like, oh man, I don't want to use gravity. I want humans, and it'd be great if I knew them. And right,
you
and
do know some humans,
but it worked out, right? And so
yeah, it did.
You know, and so that way you have real skin, real hair. You don't have to trust an artist to draw this for you, and that is really with the blend of cyberpunk that we wanted, having that real skin, real hair, real eyes, real nails, and things like that is really, really important.
Well, Keisha looks awesome in that picture, and even just the artwork that you have throughout, where you've got like the thing about the hackers, and you've got the just all of it is just really cool. I really like even in the artwork for like the character sheets where you're going with more traditional line drawing. Even that is very striking. I think you've done an excellent job with this.
Thank you. I just spent those. I really appreciate the compliment of the character sheets. That is like, you know, generation 7 of the character sheets. And we just poured a ton of time. And we had a good friend was like, go further. You can make it better. Go. Give me torn edges. And I was just like, I don't know if I can do this, John. And in the end, after like a month of us just like passing drafts back and forth, we ended up with that version. Who knows if it's still done yet, but like we kind of sat back at the end of this madness and we're just like, wow, that is actually really cool. Is it too much?
It looks really cool. It looks really cool. I think you did an excellent job with it. So can you describe the game? I know you're like, oh, great, you got 7 hours. But if you could just kind of give a nutshell of this game, I think that would really help people understand what you're kickstarting here.
Yeah, absolutely. As we've been orbiting around what this game actually is, what is Axon Punk? And so the game is a tabletop role-playing game. And the idea is that it's integrating cyberpunk with hip-hop. And so cyberpunk has always had a big musical influence. And we wanted to bring a kind of a more updated version. If you're familiar with hip-hop, you've seen a lot of interesting things where they bring cyberpunk into hip-hop, but there hasn't been a lot of bringing hip-hop into cyberpunk, especially in the tabletop role-playing world. And so inspirations like Janelle Monáe, Saul Williams, Deltron 3030, going back to Afrika Bambaataa, and things like that are really important. So we wanted to bring those in and have this with this world set in the megacities of the future, and where the people are listening to the music of the megacities, which is going to be hip-hop, rap, R&B, and it's going to be really important. And so the game is about playing people that live in these very dystopian megacities where we have megacorporation oppression, and you're trying to survive, and everyone lives in these little communities that are self-regulated, and it's really important to have this community, this grassroots cyberpunk. And so the game focuses a lot of improvisation, a lot of creativity, but also with community creation, with teamwork, with building. There's no lone wolves in this cyberpunk, because if you go off by yourself, you're just going to get overwhelmed in these overpopulated megacities. You have to work together. And that is part of why we love Axon Punk and one of the really ideas for it. And so that's what you do. You get your friends together, you build a crazy community in one of these self-regulated sections of the megacities, and you try and survive. and everybody's got trouble, everybody's got to work together, and we've got really serious teamwork rules, and but it's all about creativity and improvisation.
I love it. Yeah. I love it. You know, it's reminding me of the show. It was called The Colony. It reminds me of this, where they took random people and they threw them into this scenario that was supposed to be like post-apocalyptic. It was a simulation. Mm. But it was really cool. It would be like they took like a warehouse and they blocked off for a couple of miles around it.
Awesome.
Or maybe a mile, I'm not sure. And they left things around that they could work with. But it was really up to these people to figure it out. And they had to come together as a community. They had to figure things out. And then at some point, spoiler, they had like zombies or people show up.
Mm.
The first part of the show, like the first, like, let's say it's 8 episodes. The first 6 episodes, there's none of that. You're just watching them figure out, how are we going to have water? How are we going to have food? How are we going to? And it became really this really cool cultural experiment. When they flip the cards, then they're like, oh, look, here's some random people that are – they weren't zombies. I think they were just other – like another band, but they were attacking.
Mm-hmm.
It was like you were so invested in the culture they had built.
Yeah.
Like when the guy stabbed their water supply, he really stabbed their water supply.
Whoa.
Yeah. And you're like, these people are going to be hurt. In real life. And when you're describing your game, it seems very much like that, which is just fantastic. Like, that whole cooperative play thing really adds a dimension way beyond, I'm going to go in and hack and slash.
Yeah, right? Absolutely. And I felt that way, too, about some, you know, other things that I've seen, and we wanted that. I mean, part of this is, you know, a whole allegory for deregulation and not taking care of the environment and things like that, and really forcing people, when you abandon these people, they have to start taking care of themselves. And so, making the reality of how hard it is to get basic utilities and electricity and sanitation and things like that, you know, showing how integral central organization for some of those basic human rights is, and healthcare and things like that, you know, those are really important things. And, you know, part of this is we wrote it in 2016, we published it in 2017. I remember the weekend when Trump got elected and things like that, not to get off on politics or whatever, absolutely not. But it was just like, you know, we wrote all of this stuff before Trump got elected. So it's part of this is kind of being like, what has been going on? And we're not going to change too much of these things, but it's a bit of an update on some of this stuff.
Yeah. Well, you know what? It's like any great science fiction. You look at, I'm sure you were inspired by William Gibson.
Absolutely.
And, you know, his stuff, very paranoid. You look at when it was written compared to now, you're like, wait a minute, this stuff didn't exist, or it was on such a small scale, but he nailed it.
Yep.
One of my favorites is Philip K. Dick. I'm a huge Philip K. Dick fan.
Oh, yeah.
And same thing. Yep. I mean, he was talking about things that really became our future politically, socially, that at the time were not even considered.
Oh, yeah.
And that's what I'm getting reminded of here, this whole idea of, hey, we're set in this situation and we've got to deal with these real things. The nice thing, Colin, is it doesn't feel like I'm not escaping when I'm reading about this.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas, you know, sometimes like we tried to watch a TV show the other night and they walked into the Oval Office and we went, I can't do politics.
Yeah, right. Part of this is, you know, those are my theories and the background that I use to set the stage and do the world building. But Axon Punk, it's about playing, having fun. You know, sometimes you can take some cool things away, but it's part of having this kind of edge, a realism that you know, makes when the water supply gets stabbed, you feel it. And when with those authors, you know, those people were really inspired by, you know, the music of their days and the music of the decade before, you know, and so we are inspired by the music of you know, what's been going on the decade before and decade before that, so 90s, aughts. And so to us, and especially with that community building aspect, we listen to, you know, I draw all of that these days from like classic old school hip hop and things like, you know, Tupac, which has, you know, yes, he had his club bangers and yes, he had his issues, but also a lot of his things were extremely feminist, extremely focused on community building, extremely focused on taking care of each other. Similar things with Lauryn Hill and Erykah Badu, and you know, I'm not, you know, we can go on, but that is, you know, instead of listening to The Clash, you know, we're bringing in, you know, the idea of listening to Public Enemy for your cyberpunk. And that is how we're trying to bring in some of that freshness and integrate the, you know, the Dick with the Badu. And, yeah. You know, and,
that was a weird statement. We might not want a t-shirt.
We might want to cut that one.
No, but I liked it. I liked it. So you know? Let's talk about the music for a second. Yeah. And then I want to get into what the tiers are. Music is tied into this. Do you guys have like a playlist or anything that you work from? Or?
Yes, we do. Absolutely. Yes, yes. And so that is really, really important to us. We do the Spotify playlist a lot. My brother and I pass things constantly back and forth. We have YouTube things. And so we're going to be posting those publicly as well. And I am, you know, we're launching this. The Kickstarter is going, so back it now. And when this is launched, but you can also go to our social media, which Rob is going to be posting, and you can see that we are going to be doing a 30 days of Axon Punk Cyber Jams, where I'm going to be posting a new music video every single day, or it's not new, but it's going to be a fun video, music video, and so you can see a lot of the core influences, a lot of the visuals that we drew straight up from. A really important thing with this kind of, you know, when you're working with especially cross cultures and stuff like that, you want to make sure you are upfront about your references. You want to be sure that you're not, some of these ideas are original. Some of them are just like referencing other creative artists who are doing great things in the industry as well. So we want to be really upfront about who we're referencing from. Like, I'm a scientist, so I always want to have a good reference section. And I think that helps show authenticity and helps show appreciation for who's come before.
So, I'm expecting this to be peer reviewed and notated. that's what
the Sugar Gamers are for. So they are our peer review.
Right, they're and your peer so, review.
Absolutely. So when I, you know, when I ran it with them before the Kickstarter, you know, there was a group of, you know, three black women and you know, a couple others, and they said, you have to change this. Like, this person's name doesn't work. You have to crank up the blackness of this game.
And that's fantastic.
Absolutely.
That is fantastic.
Yeah.
Good timing on this, too. I love it. What a great project. Okay. Let's talk about your tiers. I know you've got some different tiers people can come in on. Mm-hmm. I don't know if you want to run through them, if you want to highlight a few.
Yeah. Well, the basics are that we've got, you know, we're focusing on DriveThruRPG as our distribution zone. Some of your viewers know them, some of them don't, but they're a great kind of Amazon type thing just for tabletop RPGs, and their main focus is PDF, so we're doing a lot of PDF sales, which are cheap, easy, instant deliveries. We're also doing print on demand, which is where you order the book, they make it for you. There's no backlog or weird warehouse, and you get fresh made books just for you. And so we're going to have black and white versions, we're going to have colored versions, and those are going to be available at reasonable prices with reasonable shipping, especially for international people, because DriveThru has cool print-on-demand offices on multiple continents. And so I've actually had a lot of international people say, like, hey, why don't you do print-on-demand yet? I can't, you know, that makes it so much easier for us. So we decided to switch over to that model since that's been fun, and the internet connects people all over the world. So that's kind of the basic breakdown. But in addition to the tabletop role-playing game focus, you know, there's a lot of people out there who don't have time or don't have the group or whatever to actually play the game, but have expressed interest in wanting to support us. And we decided to roll with that. And we did this for the first Kickstarter, and it was a great success. And we're really, really grateful for how it went. But we decided to, in addition to making the role-playing game book, we have a second book of short story collections that are set in the world of Axon Punk and that are written by... that are commissioned from marginalized authors, primarily women and queer people and people of color, so that it's not just stuff written by me and my brother, who are white dudes. And so we wanted to give people some of the opportunity to directly add to the Axon Punk world, to the canon. They've added some really cool things that I hadn't thought of, and it's been really worthwhile. So we did 10 stories for Axon Punk number, the first version, and then now we're hoping to do another 10 authors and 10 stories for this Axon Punk. And so that's going to be available for the people who, you know, like sci-fi, like hip-hop, like cyberpunk, but don't necessarily want to commit to a role-playing game. You can get a $10 PDF story or a $15 plus shipping PDF, or not PDF, a little sci-fi story collection. So that's also available too. So those are kind of our main focuses is, you know, PDFs, print-on-demand books, and then either these game books or the short story collection. I think we're also going to do maybe some art prints, some other things like that. Cameron's got some ideas on that. He wants to look into some posters and stuff. So hopefully we've got all that figured out. And that's our main thing. We're not doing anything crazy, nothing too expensive. That's our goal, is trying to make these things accessible for our fans.
I got to say that short story collection is a stroke of genius. I'm looking at that going, I want that. So that's quite a smart move on your part. Now, your goal for this is what?
Is 7,500. So 7,500. And, okay.
And that it goes for 30 days.
Yep, 30 days. So a lot of that is going to be going to you know, hiring external authors, getting an editor to go through this stuff for us. We had a fantastic editor who did the first version. He's coming back for this one, and paying. To be perfectly honest, as people say, you know, pay yourself for your Kickstarter. And so we budgeted a lot of this stuff for you know, a chunk of that is for me and my brother's work. We've already done a big chunk of the work in 2020, so it's a bit of back pay, but that is better for the backers because you know, it's 80% done, and we're
You know, the project's going to happen. That's a big thing, and I know that's why they put in Kickstarter. It has risks and challenges. You're overcoming those right away.
Awesome. Yeah, that's our goal.
So, what about stretch goals?
Oh yeah, yeah. So we are, you know, obviously we really hope we can push this. You know, opportunities like this with you, Rob, are really going to help us try and hit those great goals. And they're fun. And so our main goal is, like, we'd love to budget more art. That would be really phenomenal. We've got some ideas for some cool artists that we'd like to commission work from. And I would really like that. My brother's got a life focused. I mentioned we do a lot of the, you know, the main thing is these photographs. But also, like, my brother does graphic design and animation, and he went to video game school or whatever. And he has some friends in there who were offering to do a really nice, where is Ahmed from? These two really cool guys, Ahmed and Anwar, from, and they want to do some graphic design stuff for us. And I think that would be really cool where they can do these, like, cool 3D models, and we might be even able to animate them. I'm curious to see what we could do with them. But I was like, that sounds really awesome. Let's set that as a stretch goal, because we were playing a kind of a playtest version of some of the wilder things that I want to do with Axon Punk, which is like going into the deep net and doing crazy things with AIs and getting really weird on some of the cyber stuff. And they were like, I love these visuals, man. I would love to animate these for you and show you what, like, my interpretation of this is. So that would be really interesting. I think we could do some wild things, and we could even embed those in our PDFs so that you could have animated 3D, you know, rotating things or stuff like that. So that would be interesting. We'd also like to commission more authors to expand the Gonzo documents. That's the short story. We call it Gonzo Docs. And then we are, paying our authors more. Those are kind of our main things. We're not getting as crazy as we did for our first one. We kind of want to keep it low to the ground. And more authors, more artists, more art, and that's the main things.
Great. Great. So, okay. People want to go to Kickstarter to find this. They want to look up Axon, A-X-O-N, Punk, Expanded, correct?
Yes.
And why don't you also give your social media? Like I said, we'll put this in the show notes, but not everybody is a that type of learner. They might be auditory. They want to hear it. So let's hear your social media, Colin.
Absolutely. So we do a lot on Twitter, as a lot of the tabletop role-playing community is there. So you can find us on Axon Punk, you know, just all smashed together, AXONPUNK, on Twitter. We have a Facebook group for our company, Wrong Brothers Tabletop Gaming, all one long, horrible word. You can also find us on, but Facebook, we also have a Axon Punk specific group at Axon Punk. And that one's easy enough to find. We've got a page and a group, so please join us to chat and hang out. And then we're also on Instagram with wrongbrothers_gaming as well. So yeah, so please find us. We're trying to get as active as we can. The social media can be kind of fraught, but this is a way to spend some time without totally, as Rob mentioned, like totally disconnecting. I don't know. I feel like it's worthwhile research, and I feel like it's getting more timely. And I love working on the project just because it makes me, instead of going to protests, I sit down and I grind out pages on Axon Punk, and I'm like, I feel like I have a bigger impact. And obviously I support my friends who go to protests and my roommates who did that too. But I, as a white dude, am better off writing and expanding things. So that's part of why I care. So anyways.
Wonderful. Wonderful, Colin. All right. Well, thank you so much for being on. Good luck with this. The date that this starts actually should be about the day that this episode comes out, which is Thursday the 23rd, correct?
Yeah. Thursday. We are dropping July 23rd Thursday, and we're going to go for 30 days, so that ends August 22nd.
Wonderful. That's it. Thank you so much, Colin, and good luck with this.
Yeah, thank you so much, Rob. We really appreciate it. Can't thank you enough.
I've put the link to the Kickstarter in the show notes, and we'll also have it on posts at our social media. Once again, sharing this project with your followers and friends is key, so please be an active participant and spread the word. While you're in the mood, please share this episode. That draws attention to this show, which we can always use. Oh, and please rate and review us. It only takes a few seconds and makes a huge impact on how many people see when we post a new episode. If you have a crowdfunding project, reach out to me at southgatemediagroup@gmail.com, on Twitter @rsouthgate, or on Facebook @GoFundThisPodcast. Tell me a little about the project or what you create, and I'll consider featuring it on the show. I would love to help you make your project a reality. Thanks for listening, everyone. Until next time, go fund this.